care metrics.
It gives us the opportunity to put a third variable in your equation. When you go to your y equals, don't write this down. When you go to your y equals, you do something, you make a line. You make a parabola. You throw a ball in the air. It comes back down. You make a parabola. When you make this parabola, you throw the ball, rocket, launch something. You start here, it makes the highest it can, comes back down, hits the ground. You have two variables that you can measure. Generally, your y is your height. Your x depends. Most of the time, your x is your time. So over time, this goes so high. So after 2 seconds, I am at the highest that I can be. 3 feet, whatever my height is. Sometimes they make this distance. Vertical, horizontal distance. So you measure a vertical distance, you measure a horizontal distance. I throw a ball. It goes in the air, comes back down. It went as high as 4 feet high, and it went 6 feet away from me. How long did that take? I don't know. I could only measure two things. So parametrics allows us to put a third variable. So what we get now is we get a height, we get a horizontal distance, and a time. And time is going to travel this way. Time is going to be our third parametric, our third variable. So when I chart this thing, I could say this is 0.1 seconds, 0.2 seconds, 0.3. This is 1 second. 1 second, I'm right here. You guys do this in physics, right? Have you done this in physics yet? You should by now, right? Kinda. Who has physics? Okay. You didn't see this in physics?
Yeah.
You don't. Right. You don't.
Yeah,
right. You do yours a little differently. When I took physics also, I took it in high school and I took it in college. We used to call these snapshots. You took a snapshot of where your rocket is. At the end of 2 hours, where is your rocket? And then you chart your path and figure out, did you go off path? Are you on path? And I don't remember anything but calling them snapshots. So what we have now is we're going to be able to take the time and figure out where we are. So now our time could be 2.1 seconds, our height could be 3 feet, and our distance from here to here could be 4 feet. So we're gonna be able to figure out three different things. Now, in your calculators, we're gonna work parametrics. So where your mode is, you're gonna come down to where it says function, F-U-N-C. You're going to scroll to the right to PAR, parametrics. All I ask is that when you finished at the end of this class, you just go back and set it up to function, because all the other kids will be so lost when this comes up and they don't know how to get out of this. So at the end, I'll just remind you, please reset your calculator. Just do a reset memory. I don't care. Or just go back and set this. Now, once you hit parametrics, go to your y equals. Notice there's two sets of equations, and x equals y equals. Logan, put this in your calculator. Let's do this together, guys. So we're going to change your parametric setting. You're going to get an x equal, a y equals. You physics guys should like this. We have velocities, we have angles. Okay, so for every equation, you're going to get a pair of equations. And our pair of equations is what's going to drive this thing. And if you notice, do you see the T for time? You have an X in terms of time, you have a Y in terms of time. When you hit this X value over here, just hit your X, this is where your time comes in. As soon as you hit X, that's where your time comes in. So it's kind of like a rate times time thing. Rate times time. We always have a rate times time. All right, so once we get this started, we're just bypass the front part. I don't even know why that's there. Okay, we're gonna go to graphing your parametrics. Now everything is graphed in terms of time. This is where your x would have been, Now we're getting your x1 equation, your y1 equation. You have a pair of equations, and each pair of equations is based on the time. So let's go put this in your calculator and see what this looks like. There's a lot going on here. So we're going to put in t squared minus 4 and y equals t over 2. All right, so now we're going to go to your chart from negative 2 to 3. Here's a problem. We have to set your window up. Hit your window. We have a t max, a t min. We added an extra variable. We have your x max, your x min, your y min, your y max. Now, we also have what is called a t step, and I'll get to the t step in a second. Now, your t min is going to be your time. If it's an application, you're going to say time is from 0 to whatever you think could possibly, if you're launching a rocket, throwing a ball, going on a Ferris wheel, whatever your time happens to be. If I give you a table, there's your t min, your t max. So your t min is negative 2, your t max is 3. Now I want you just to put your t step to 0.2 right now. I don't know where my x min and my x maxes are going to be. I don't know what this is going to give to me. I could look at my table, but I'm just saying, let's say we don't know where this is going. Let's just take graph. Okay. Now, I have something that starts somewhere and it opens up and keeps on going. Were we ever able to graph this before? So bless you. Is this a function? No, this is not a function. We were never able to graph this before. I didn't know if you caught where this was going, so I'm going to take my time step and I'm going to slow it down. I'm going to slow it down a lot. So now just watch up here 1 second when I hit graph. See where it started right here? This is how it travels. This is when time is negative 2. Then it keeps on going up like this. Then it goes up to here till time is 3. It backtracks over itself. Something is moving. Same thing when you throw a ball, you shoot a rocket, you throw any equation in there, something starts. And we call this orientation, the path that it makes. So when we sketch this, I'm going to sketch this like this. This is where it goes. This shows my orientation, the little arrows. This shows my orientation. This is very basic today, but if you kind of see what's happening here, we can actually make a circle. We can make an ellipse. We can make a hyperbola because we can make things that are not functions. And we can throw a ball, we can launch a rocket, we can keep track of a lot of things. Now, when you're looking at your calculator, if I'm going negative 2 to 3, these are the pairs that you're plotting. 0, negative 1. That's my 0, negative 1. Negative 3, 0.5. That's my negative 3, negative 0.5. Here's my negative 4, 0. Right there is my negative 4, 0. See it? I can't put a dot on the board because then I lose my calculator. So this is the time, your third parameter. That's this movement. These are your x, y coordinates. You're still plotting your x and y. Your time is what's moving around you. Kind of makes sense? It's kind of cool, isn't it? This is like my favorite part of pre-calc. I love parametric.
Does it stay this easy?
Because
I really hope it does.
I would hope for you too that it would, but it gets a little bit harder, just a little. So if you stay with me from the beginning, you shouldn't notice it getting any harder. Because the concept will never change. This is the basic concept. What might change is how we set our x-mins and maxes. When we hit the applications, so if we're going to go 5,000 feet in the air, obviously I can't graph this and show 5,000 feet. I have to change my window. So changing your windows is probably the hardest part that you'll have to do. But basic sketch is basic sketch. Okay?
Is there like 45 different formulas?
There is no real formula. It's just an X. And, well, I can't say that. There is a little bit of a basic formula. A little bit. A little bit of a basic formula. So here is what you would plot from here to here. That gives us this. And notice we stopped right there because we only went up to 3. This was my starting point at the 0. This was my ending point. And my end says, doesn't like me. 3, at the time when it's 3, 5, 1.5. So this one right here is 5, 1.5. And you can see a pattern. This allows us to graph things that are not functions because it's done over time. So if you can almost imagine this coming back around, we could almost make an ellipse, which we will pretty soon. Okay? Basically, today, I just want you to get used to doing this. This was your starting point because it went from negative 2 to 3. I missed the negative 2. Where was the negative 2? Negative 2 was 0, negative 1. This was your point right here. When it got to 3, this was at t is negative 2. This is t is 3.
I got it.
So it goes in a path, and you only plot your x and your y. All right, so let's try another one. Try to put this in your calculator. We'll work on the t-step when we get to this. Because the t-step, if x has an increment and y has an increment, t has an increment. They just call it a step. It's just like an increment. How do you want to set up your time for this? So let's go to your x and your y. Remember, as soon as you go hit this xt theta n, and the next thing we learn is the theta when we do polar, so you're going to learn a lot of these things. So when we put this in, we're going to do a t squared, and we're going to do a t cubed. Okay. We're going to go from negative 4 to positive 4. When we started this, we hit mode, and we went to parametrics. And when you come to this equation, you just hit where the x is. So you got to stay with me from the beginning of this. So from negative 4 to positive 4. Now, let's put your t-step back just to 0.1 right now. I don't know where my x and my min are going. Yes.
What does the t-step do?
Okay, I'm about to show you. Just like you have increments for C, your scale, x, min, and max, and you have an x scale, how do I want to set this up? That's what my t-step does. I just had started to say that. I started to say it has an increment, which we call a step. But I'm going to show you with this one, because this one's going to look a little strange. So when you go to graph this, it kind of looks like this. Does yours look like this? Okay. Now, come to your window and change t-step to be 1. Now graph. Looks a little crooked now, right? It's not so smooth. Does yours look like this? Not so smooth. We want to try to get these lines as smooth as possible. That's what your t-step does. Now, if you look at like x and y increments, if you're going to go from... Remember, sometimes we change the increments off of 1 if we go to like thousands, because what it does in yours is darken these things a lot. So we say, all right, we can increment by 100, we can increment by 1,000, and you'll see where your increments go. Mostly, like we do that for trig functions, so we can see where our angles are going.
In your window, where it was the x min, x max, and x scale, why is it like a bunch of numbers like that? Like mine just came as the thing.
Yeah, it will. It'll just say all different things. Yeah. When we get to the applications, we'll worry about those. God bless you. But the regular graph, God bless you. It'll take care of itself. What we have to take care of is your t-step. If I only go from negative 4 to positive 4, I'm not going for very long. So I don't want my increment to be very high. So don't change yours. Just watch up here for a second. If I go to 2, watch how fast this goes. It's pretty fast. It goes pretty fast. If I change this to 0.01, watch how slow it goes. See how slow it goes? So that's your increment, kind of like an X. If I'm only going from 0 to 10, I can put my increments at 1. I can put my increments at 0.5. I can put my increments at 5. And I'll just see those come out. We don't see your increments for t-step because we don't have an axis for t, right? Time is this. Time is moving this way. So that's what your t-step is doing. If I change my increment, just watch 1 second. If I change my, let's put this at negative 10. Let's put this at positive 10. Let's put this at 1. Okay? Watch my X.
That's crazy.
Okay, watch my X. See my increments over here? They go from 1 to 10, right? Okay? This does the same thing. You just have to visualize this is a different dimension. I'm going to change my increments to 5. Well, look where it is. Well, I'm only incrementing from here to here, but look where my increment is, from 0 to 5. There's my increment. Now, when you change your t-step, you can't see it because it doesn't belong to an axis. Your time is what's moving here. So it makes sense if you make your time slower, smaller, you're going to see it move slower. If you change it higher, if I make my t-step high to 2, it's going to zip. You're not even going to see it. It's at 2, whoop, done. This is my time. I have no axis for time. Time is where my movement is. So we don't really say scale, because there's no scale, but you're not on any scale. You're at a step, your time. How do you want me to run this? How do you want me to walk this through? So ideally what we want is to find a step where I can see it move. It's the closest to a straight line that I can get to, not a crooked line. So generally we say, like, if the numbers are close, keep this number small. 0.3, and see, that's kind of a little loopy. So maybe I want to go a little less. 0.1. That was terrible. And we just have to play with it. This is the part that's hardest to see. If I go too slow, it's going to take a long time. This isn't taking a long time because I'm only going from negative 4 to positive 4. But watch what happens, and I just want you to play with this today. Watch what happens if I go negative 20 to positive 20. Whoops. Now, watch with my step. Pretty slow. Because you want me to go from negative 20 to positive 20 at 0.02. You want me to go really slow. This guy is extremely slow. Extremely slow. Still turning. There he goes. Very slow. So if I'm going that far apart this time around, it's still going.
You can stop.
Yeah. I'm just letting it go. It'll stop soon. Second off. Second on. Usually that stops. It just cuts it off. So if I'm here, and I just want you to play with this for a little bit. So I might want to set my step to 1. A little bit fast, change it. Go to 0.5. Is that better? No, it's better. Fast, but better. Can I pretty much see my graph? Maybe I only want to go to 0.3. Generally, you're going to keep your step small because that's what you're doing. A little crooked. There's a little crooked between 0.3 and 0.5, right? So maybe I'll try 0.4. All I want you to do today is to play with this. Just get used to this, what this is looking at, Yet you said changing your step. Your step is the one that doesn't have a scale. Your X has a scale, your Y has a scale. Your time is what's going this way in movement. Once we get to applications, it makes so much more sense. When we want to rocket, when we hit a golf ball, there's a lot of golf. Any of you golfers in here? I know you are. You are? Okay. Mr. Nee used to do pre-calc honors like years ago. And for those of you that go to calculus, he does calc next year. But he did a lot of these applications, and they're all about golf. So you hit a golf, you hit your golf ball, it has to clear a tree, it has to miss a sand pit, it has to, how close will you get to the hole if you hit it at a certain velocity for a certain time. So we work velocities, we work times, and that makes a little bit more sense. These were just getting you used to third parameter. Your third parameter is what's moving. I can still graph this. When I go to my table, I can graph this. If we want to go from negative 4 to positive 4, this is what I'm looking at. Those are my x, y values. 16, negative 64. I lose mine. 9, negative 27. Do you see it come up? 0, 0. 1, 1. 1, negative 1. So I'm going like this. This is my 0, 0. This is what this is going to look like. Your T-step is what works this right in here. That's why we don't call it a scale, we call it a step. You want to get something close to a smooth curve, but not too fast that you can't see it, because we need to tell orientation. So where did this graph start? In what quadrant? Quadrant 4. So my orientation is going to go like this. If you draw a little arrow, this is called orientation. So you're just, if you're going to plot me orientation, it's going to look like this. I have to be able to see where it starts, where it stops. If it goes too fast, how do you change your T-step? Make it larger or smaller? Smaller. If it goes too slow, make it a little larger. Pay attention to what your window is. Like if we're only going from negative 4 to positive 4, your T-step can't be large because you're in a little area too. That's the ones we want to look at. Granted, your graph goes the whole screen regardless, but if we set it up, you want to be able to see it go. If you go to do, this is another thing. If you go to graph this guy, so say I graphed it. Now notice the second time I hit graph, it doesn't redo it for me. If I want to redo it and say, oops, I didn't see where did this graph start, if I hit graph again, it won't graph it. I need to go change my step. Even if I change my step slightly, now I'll be able to see it. But as soon as you hit graph again, it won't regraph it. Well, unless you change something. So just make sure you make a change for you to be able to see it. Like sometimes you're going to go for orientation, but you didn't see where it started. So if you hit graph again, you're still not going to see it. Once you change your step, you will. So tomorrow when we get to this and we plot your ellipses on this, because we were able to plot your ellipses before. Remember, we couldn't get to your ellipses. So we did it this way. Tomorrow we'll do it using this. And then by the third day, we'll hit applications. And by the time you get to applications, I'm just hoping that you're comfortable enough with this.